Hi everyone, and welcome to Tapping Into Your Creativity in my studio. Today we have an incredible guest artist. I'm super excited to bring her on, Betty Krause. She is joining us from the San Francisco Bay Area, and she is right there, and she's gonna join us right now, and we're gonna talk about Betty. What an incredible artist she is. She's an abstract contemporary artist, and she's gonna join us any minute. And there she is.
Hello.
Hi, Betty, welcome. I'm so excited that you're joining me today.
I am excited to be here, Sandra. How are you?
I'm really good. Last time I saw you, we were the opposite. You were interviewing me for the project. So it feels good to be on this side where I feel a little more comfortable, I guess.
That's awesome. Yes, I remember that. That was great.
Yes. So tell us, Betty, where are you? Who are you? Where are you from? Everything. We want to know everything about you.
Oh, sure. Well, first, I just want to say, Sandra, thank you so much for interviewing me, for giving me this opportunity to chat with you today and to just give everyone else an opportunity to listen in and learn more about what you've been doing. And congratulations on raising $10,000 for Feeding America, which I think is so wonderful.
Yes, it's amazing. Like I call it, my army of artists have helped me tremendously to achieve this, and you're part of that army of artists. So thank you so much. I couldn't do this without you guys. So the amount of gratitude that I have for you all is incredible. So welcome, thank you, and thank you for supporting me and this incredible journey.
Thank you, honored to be here. All right, so a little bit about me. I am actually here in sunny California, so it's gonna be another 90 degree day here, which I absolutely love because I am a hot weather person. I live for hot weather. 90 degrees is like the perfect temperature for me. If it could be 90 every day, I would be so happy.
Oh my gosh, that's great. Because right now in Minneapolis, I feel like it's 95 with 100% humidity. So it was way too hot to be in my studio. So I'm home today because it was just going to be way too hot to be down there.
Yeah, no, we don't have humidity here like you guys do. So I think that's why I especially enjoy this weather because, you know, when I was young in my 20s, I did a lot of traveling back east. And I just remember, you know, stepping out of the air-conditioned hotel room, and it's like all my clothes clung to me immediately. My makeup started coming down off my face. So I feel for you.
Yeah, that's in the state that we are at the moment.
Yes, totally.
So it's
understand.
90 and beautiful. And let me just start by asking you, is your studio at home or do you have to go somewhere? Do you work somewhere else?
Yeah, so I have two studios. So I've got one here. I am in my garage studio. And it's, of course, attached to my home. It's a single car garage. So I've got the door closed. And I do have water heaters in here and storage. And this is where I started. So when I grew up here in San Jose, California, and when I was in my late 20s, I moved to Southern California for about 7 years. That's where my daughter was born. And then when she was 6 months old, we moved up to Seattle, Washington. And we spent almost 20 years in Seattle. So I am really super happy to be back in the Sunshine State. We moved back here about 4 years ago. And so I just love being here. And as soon as we moved back, I set up this space as my studio so that I was working from home, which I absolutely love because I didn't feel like I had to get in a car and go to a job. It felt, you know, it didn't feel like a job, which is what I wanted. Last year, I decided I needed to create bigger. And actually, I had a really huge commission that I needed to do, which was a 60 by 60 inch. So I didn't have enough wall space here to do it. I would have had to reconfigure. So I decided that I would rent out space in downtown San Jose, which I've been doing since last October. And I absolutely love that space. It's kind of like having almost a three-car garage. And it's just very spacious.
By yourself? That's all for you?
Yes, by myself. And I love it because I don't have it cluttered like I have here. I've got a lot of stuff still here. And so it's really my space to paint larger. So I rarely paint small on paper. I do a lot of that here. But I tend to paint larger pieces of paper or definitely large canvases. So I've got a lot of room to spread out. I've got a couple of chairs in there. I've got an ottoman so I can kick back and relax a bit and observe what I'm, you know, creating.
So those pictures where I see that you have your cross legs sitting, it's in your studio.
That is right. That's my downtown studio. Yes.
Yes. So tell us a little bit about your background as a professional. What did you do, and when did you decide that this was really your passion and that you were really going to throw yourself into it?
Sure. So my career has mostly been in high-tech companies as a customer service manager. So I've been on that kind of service end of the industry for over 25 years. And it wasn't until I turned 50, so that was 6 years ago, that I decided that I wanted to get creative. So, and actually it was just before my 50th birthday, I started, I was making, for a number of years, I was making cards, you know, stamping cards and making them perfect and spending like hours on the weekend because I was working full time. So spending hours just trying to make these perfect cards, you know, if the stamp wasn't perfect, I had to start all over. But I still love that process. And then somewhere along the way, I stumbled upon mixed media, I think on the internet somewhere. And I still remember that feeling and where I was, that madly in love feeling of, oh my God, this is what I want to do. This is what I want to be creating. And what I loved about mixed media was that when you stamped something and it wasn't perfect, that made it perfect. Mm-hmm. And that was for me. So that my early love of layering happened then. A little bit, you know, even when I was making cards, I loved to layer up, you know, doing card on top of card or stamping. And
collaging, I had an early love so for it's that. Like a little bit of collage in there too.
Yeah. So when I was doing mixed media, definitely collage was involved. I was doing, of course, you know, with paints and stencils and stamping and just whatever I can find, I was adding to my pieces. And I started small, you know, I started doing them on these small little 4x6 pieces of paper. And then I kind of grew from there. So I spent my first few years doing mixed media work. And then I started doing kind of whimsical flowers and birds. And because I am not, I didn't go to school for art. I cannot draw. Please don't ask me to draw something because I'm not good at that. But I do have this love for layering and expressing myself through mark making and through colors. So after I did that for a few years, in the summer of 2015, if I remember correctly now, I decided that I wanted to be an abstract painter because I really was starting to fall in love with abstract work. And I just wanted to be part of that. So I made a decision. I was at a workshop. The workshop had nothing to do with being an abstract painter, but it was just kind of my line in the sand to say, okay, from this day forward, I want to be an abstract painter. And so I want to dedicate my time to that. So I boxed up all of my mixed media works in terms of the tools and supplies. I boxed up everything. I sold a lot of stuff. I got rid of a lot of stuff. I gave away a lot of stuff. Because I wanted to really focus on just creating mixed media, focus on abstract work. And in order to do that, I couldn't be distracted with my mixed media stuff because I really loved doing that, but I wanted to do this other thing. So I spent the last, you know, since that
2015,
time.
Yeah,
since 2015, I've been focused on trying to be an abstract painter and really kind of fell into the type of work that I create today about 2 years ago. When I went overseas to visit my parents in Croatia, my mom and I would go for walks through the village. And I was there in the springtime where wildflowers are blooming everywhere. And so we would pick these, and my mom would make these little bouquets. And I love these. And she'd bring them home, and we'd have little bouquets all over the house. And it was then that I realized that I was creating these bouquets of flowers and these fields of flowers that I was seeing that were in my subconscious that I was putting out on paper, because I was creating on paper during my trips.
So I think that what is important, that what you've said so far, is really you started when you were 50. I think that, you know, for younger people that, or for older people that have said, well, if I don't do anything by whatever age, then I'm done. And it's so not true. You can reinvent yourself at whatever age and stage of life that you're in, as long as your heart and soul is in it. And absolutely. The second thing that you just said, which I think it's amazing, is that your paintings feel like you are in a field of flowers and you're embracing them. And the colors and the love of those flowers, and even the smells and the textures, you've brought it into your paintings. And I think that also because of trial and error, and because you started with cards, that probably that informed you to where you wanted to go. I think that you have accomplished your own language in a non-objective way, correct?
Yeah, I do feel that I have. And, you know, when I'm creating, I do feel that I'm in this field of flowers, or I'm in a bouquet of flowers. You know, I'm surrounded by the colors of them, the smells of them, the textures of them. And that's what I'm trying to convey in my paintings.
And let me ask you, how is COVID has affected you in a way that you're working? Because I think that you have continued a very rigid routine from what I can see, and from you know, how we know each other. I see that you have kept yourself with a routine and showing up every day. So how, if it has affected you in any way?
Yeah, so you know, I think I've been really fortunate. I was in Mexico just before the announcement that we were going to, that, well, I should say I came back 2 days before we, in California, we shut down. So shelter in place went into place, and I only had a couple of days when I got back. I spent 2 weeks in Mexico at an art retreat with a bunch of lovely ladies that I truly miss. And it was a wonderful time to just create and relax and enjoy. But a little hard that second week when we were paying attention to what was going on in the United States. And I could feel the stress starting to build up in me. You know, are we going to make it home? Or, you know, is there going to be a flight for us? So all of that was a bit stressful. When I came back, I think that I would have to say that the first couple of months of COVID have been the busiest time for me for a number of reasons. So I was supposed to be teaching in-person workshops, and I've had to cancel all of those this year or push them out to next year. So in order to kind of compensate for that, because I lost a lot of money, I did a lot of refunds because I did cancel 3 workshops. So I had to refund all of that money myself. There are other workshops that I'm partnered with somebody else. So I've kept those and I've pushed those out to next year. So in order to help me out with that, I ended up doing a live online workshop, which has been fabulous. So I did one actually in January, which I really loved.
Before
all of this even happened. Right. Yeah. So in January, I did my very first, what I called Paint with Betty session, and it's 2 hours online. And It was fabulous. We created a piece, from start to finish. I answered questions throughout the entire process, made the recording available to everybody so they can rewatch it as many times as they'd like. So that was great. So I took that and I did it again. So instead of that weekend when I was supposed to be in New Mexico for an in-person workshop, I taught an online workshop instead. And so it was great. And what I did was, because of COVID-19, I cut my price in half. So I was offering it at half price, which was great. I had over 350 people sign up for it. So it was
amazing.
And again, I had so much fun. And so I did it again a couple of weeks ago. And this time I created larger. So the first two times I worked smaller on paper so that everybody can see my desktop. But this last time I worked up on the wall on paper, and that was great too. So again, I was able to answer questions for everybody and go through that whole process with them, and they've got the recording. And then I've also got that recording available now. So if anybody, I get emails from people asking if they can still purchase it. And yes, you can still purchase it. It's on my website, or just message me and I'll send you the link. So it's a just over two hour recording, and talking through my process, about products.
So just to go back for a second, because I think we missed when you decided, okay, I feel comfortable enough now in what I do, and now I'm going to turn around and teach. So when did that happen, and how easy or hard has it been, and where did you learn the skills to now be able to teach?
So I made the transition from being an artist to a teacher a couple of years ago, where I started teaching when I was still up in Seattle. So actually going back a ways, I was teaching art journaling classes up in the Seattle area. So that was during my mixed media days. Absolutely loved doing that. And then when I came down here, I didn't teach for a number of years. Certainly didn't teach the way I create today. So I was teaching what I knew back then. Last year, I think it was last year or the year before, I want to say, is when I taught my first in-person workshop, and totally enjoyed doing that. And so this year I decided to, so last year I taught, I think, two of them, and they were just here in the Bay Area. And then this year I set up like five of them. And of course, COVID happened, so I couldn't do the in-person, but I transitioned. And really, my teaching goes way back, not teaching art, but when I was younger, when I was in my late teens, I taught summer school. I taught a typing class. So I was starting to learn how to teach back then. Being Croatian, I grew up in the Croatian community in the Bay Area, and I was a folk dancer for many years. I also taught children to folk dance. So my teaching skills kind of came from different areas. So being able to teach art, I kind of already knew how to break down steps and how to talk through a process, and to, show the tools that you're using, and to discuss, my thought process behind them. So I already kind of had an understanding of how to do that. So the transition wasn't too difficult for me.
Okay, good. Because I think that, it's not easy. You can be a really amazing artist, but, to make that transition to actually be able to, teach somebody else, you need a little bit of a skill. So your background really helped you to be able to really, put yourself in front of people and teach them and talk through it, and talk technique and talk material and talk composition and talk value. So I think it's a little bit of everything that, that kind of, I think the stars aligned for you at a certain point, and it just was like, okay, let's do it right.
Right. And also, and I forgot to mention this part, actually several years ago, my now friend Jeannie Douglas actually messaged me. She lives in the Bay Area. She's up about 2 hours north of me. And she emailed me and said, "Do you teach?" And my first response was going to be, "No, I don't." But then I thought about it. I said, why not? Let me give this a try. So really that first year, and I totally forgot about this, that first year and a half, I was doing in-person workshops in my home one-on-one. So 6 hours, for 6 hours, I would have them come in. I would make lunch for us and we would spend 6 hours together. So I was learning how to do the teaching part and refine it a lot more before I did the larger in-person workshops.
Yeah. And I think, you know, also as a teacher and as an artist, it's important to do all those workshops, yes. to do them yourself as an artist. And you never stop learning, right? So you always totally. Want to better yourself and you always want to find new techniques, find new materials. And I think that, you know, this platform that I've given to artists have been all the artists have been so generous in really showing and teaching us what they use, what works for them, what not doesn't work for them. So I think it's a little bit of everything. It's like we're all teaching each other. And sometimes I feel artists are not necessarily willing to share their process. But I mm-hmm. think that because of the situation that we're in right now, we are all wanting to share everything yep. to help people at home.
Absolutely. The community is wonderful. And, you know, what you said about, you know, taking workshops, I also love to continue to take workshops. I try to take in-person workshop at least once a year. Nancy Hillis is, and I know you had her on not too long ago, but she was one of the early first online workshops that I took. So absolutely love taking a workshop with her. And I love doing the in-person workshops because I really like being right there, touching the materials with the instructor, with the other students. And you just build this community, which is absolutely wonderful. And it just, it helps get you through difficult times like we're going through now.
It's so important to have a community of artists to, you know, throw yourself into and be able to speak the same language. Because sometimes, you know, you have amazing friends, but not necessarily they understand what is happening in here when your mind is going 360 miles per hour and you can't sleep because you're painting in the middle of the night. And so when you find that community that speaks your same language, it is crucial. And it's crucial for everything, really. It helps with critiques. It helps to grow. It helps to build connections. It helps to always have that knowing that you're not alone. That you have right. this incredible yeah. connection.
Yeah. And it's so, not just yeah, and it's not just the creating of art, but it's also the business side of art. You know, you learn so much from others.
Right. And people are willing to help. I mean, you just yes. have to ask. But I think people are really willing to help out. And we can actually just talk briefly about Instagram. You grew your Instagram account in such short period of time. If you really think about it, 2015 to now, I mean, it's a short amount of time to have the amount of followers that you have. So can you talk to us a little bit about that?
Yeah, sure. So I actually started my account in March of 2016. I started it on my sister's birthday, so it's easy to remember that date. And, you know, that first year, I didn't really know what I was doing. Instagram was so new to me. And being an artist, trying to figure out my abstract style was so new to me that, you know, I kind of felt scattered. I was kind of doing a little bit of this, a little bit of that. But I was posting on a regular basis. So I was posting pretty much every day what I was creating. And then new features came along. So stories came along. So I started looking at stories and figuring out how to do stories. IGTV came along. I started doing IGTV videos. One person that really helped me a lot is Sue B. Zimmerman of The Instagram Expert. That's her handle on Instagram. She's got a ton of great ideas. She still does today. So I continue to follow her. I always pick up something. Like I just learned that you can pin comments that people put on your post. You can pin 3 comments. I was like, no way, I didn't know that. And so now I'm going through and I'm like pinning comments. That way when people come see, you know, you want them to see certain comments that people yeah. made about you. So following people, learning, I think what I really did a lot to grow my following is to better understand Instagram. And, you know, we all talk about the algorithms and we hate the algorithms, right? But, you know, life changes. Everything's always changing. So you just got to, instead of resist, you got to go with the flow, and you've got to learn, and you've got to try new things and figure things out. And that's really the approach that I took. What I did a lot of the time also is when I was creating, I'd set up my computer, and I would be on YouTube, and I would be listening to business talk about Instagram or running a business. And so that was always kind of like going into my subconscious. So I was always listening to ideas and suggestions. I couldn't do everything. It is so difficult to do everything. But if I could just take one thing once a day or once a week and just learn something new and start implementing it, I found that all those things really helped propel me forward on my Instagram account. It got me to 10,000. And then from there, you know, once you hit 10,000, it starts to multiply a lot faster, you know, getting to 25, 50. And, you know, I'm over 100,000 now. And I'm so honored, so excited. And just, you know, the feedback that I get from everybody just pushes me forward, makes me want to create more, makes me want to share more of what I'm doing. So it's been really
exciting. Definitely food for your soul, because they are very loyal followers. They are positive followers. And, you know, it's important that your following loves your work and loves what you do. And they're not just following, you know, just because. So it is important to nurture your followers. You don't want to have 100K that don't care about your work, right?
Right. So that comes down to, don't buy, you know, don't go into buying lists or getting people to follow you because you want to get those numbers up. You want to build them one at a time, which is what I did. Now, did I try doing purchasing and, you know, paying for a post somewhere? I did that a few times, and I found that it just doesn't work because they're really not interested, or it's a feed that has all realism, and then you see my abstract. It's like nobody's going to follow me because they were interested in seeing, you know, realism. So,
Exactly.
I learned from that and preferred to just, you know, one person at a time.
Yeah, and saying that about Instagram and not knowing how our world is changing so much, I just had Allison Stanfield, who's an artist business consultant. And we talked about how important it is to actually nurture your email list, your mailing list, your newsletters, and how important that is. Because that really, at the end of the day, if anything happens with Instagram or Facebook or YouTube or whatever, you can still have this incredible mailing list of people that really want to hear back from you, right?
So absolutely. Yes, I've been building that for the last few years. I wish I had started earlier. So if you're out there and you haven't started yet, start today because it is just so important. And for folks who are trying to build up their Instagram following, I do have my top 10 things to do on Instagram that's on my website. So if you go to my website, Betty Krause Art, go to where it says workshops, the tab for workshops, and then it'll drop down and you'll see my top 10. And it's free. Help yourself to that. And those are the things that have worked for me.
Awesome. I'm going to put all of our information on my feed when I post this. So this is very exciting. Okay. So now let's move on to the real fun stuff, which is your artwork.
Sure.
What have you been working on? And can you show us a little bit about your process? And we know your inspiration, but let's talk about your process and what you're thinking when you're going to create, and show us a little bit about your work. And let's talk about that.
Yeah. So,
I'm going to take the comments off so we can actually see Betty with everything behind her. And then I'll turn them on at the end for questions.
Okay. Sounds great. So in terms of my process, you know, I do have a lot of videos on YouTube, and you can certainly watch me create over there, both on paper and also on larger pieces on canvas. So, and I just posted a new one. I think it was last week. It was a commission that I did. So I like to start with mark making. And, you know, you interviewed Nancy Hillis recently.
Yeah.
And, you know, when I came to her, she did her first online workshop, and I participated in that, which was wonderful.
How lucky.
And I know. So Coming into that workshop, I loved mark making, but the one thing that I really learned in that workshop is to be confident with my mark making and to truly love every mark that I make, because every mark that I make is my mark. And that was the biggest takeaway that whole workshop did for me. And so, you know, when I do mark making, you know, I don't hesitate. I don't worry about it. I don't think about it. I don't question it. I used to question it and say, oh, is that a good mark? Should I have done that mark? And now it's like, they're all good. They're all perfect. And so I tend to start like this. This one's just on a piece of paper. I did this one in my recent online workshop as an example of loosening up and getting started. So all of my pieces, whether I'm working on paper or on canvas, I like to start with mark making. With a pencil, I always love to start with pencil first, just a regular number two pencil. And then I go into using different types of mark making. Here's my whole little tray of them. Different like Prismacolor pencils. I like the Woodies that are crayons. I like Neocolor crayons. Yeah. So just starting with mark making and loosening up. Half the time, I don't even look at my paper. I'm just like, I want to start moving my hands around. I want to start getting into that motion. So I like to start with that. I also talk a bit about my different types of mark making that I like to do. So because I'm inspired by fields of flowers and by nature, I tend to do a lot of circles, you know, representing flowers. I like to do lines because for me, lines represent stems or trees, branches. You know, I don't do a whole lot vertical or horizontal lines, like not horizontal. Is that the, no, what's the word I'm looking for?
Perpendicular or.
Coming in at an angle.
Yes. Yeah.
I don't do a whole lot of those because those tend to be kind of add more tension. So if I do them, they're really soft. I tend to do things very much vertical. Or horizontal. So I've got, you know, larger circles. I've got marks like this tend to represent stepping stones for me because I love stepping stones. So if you see this in my artwork, it's representing stepping stones. I like fences that are old and broken and falling down. So you might see something like this in my artwork where it kind of starts to fall downward. So that's my love for old fences. So
okay, can we put that up for a minute again? Because what I see there is you're created a language. So it's your own interpretation of non-objective art. So what you have there is a repetition of figures. You know, you have some geometrical shapes. You have some rhythm, right? So when you're creating those little marks, they are some sort of a rhythm. You have community of elements. And when you are creating all that, it automatically becomes a non-objective language. And so, so that is a perfect example of what you have created as your own language. I love that. That's fantastic.
Thank you. Yes, so that is my diagonal. The word I was looking for is diagonal. I don't do a whole lot at a diagonal. Yeah. Yes, these all represent, you know, when I put them all together, they're representing my love for fields of flowers, for flowers in general. It could be a close-up of a flower. It could be a bouquet of flowers. These are all marks that I use consistently throughout all my paintings in a variety of different ways. So they could be solid, they could be outlined, they could be large, they could be small, they could have hard edges, they could have soft edges. So I'm trying to do a whole lot of variety as I pull my paintings together. So that's an example there. And then as I get started, I use a lot of black in my first layer. So after I do my mark making, I put down a lot of black and then I start adding some color to it. So this is an example of just, you know, I can see some red. So I've got an earlier layer under there and then I've got these blues and greens. So a second layer here. So I would continue building.
Can you put it a little closer in so we can see what you're, there we go. Okay, great. So what you're creating with the black is really giving us a depth. So you're starting all your layers. And what happens is that they become like planes inside the painting. And so that's why it's important to use, the saturation, especially if you're starting with black, to start at the very beginning and then yes. build up with lighter colors.
Yes, yes. I've tried it the opposite way, and I didn't like that black sitting floating up on top. That just
doesn't
didn't represent
yeah.
the flowers for me. But
yeah.
this, with just a little bit of black showing through, just reminds me of earth and the depth and what it kind of gets pushed into the background as
right.
As
it's
all
not
these flowers.
As heavy. Black can be very heavy,
yeah.
or it could be very light. So it just
right,
depends on
right.
how you use it. The way that you're using it by building up these layers is that it creates a very light layer.
Yeah.
You can purposely use black, at the end of the layer to really
sure.
make a statement. And you have to be very decisive when you do that.
Yes, yes. So the other thing I've been working on, so that's a quick example of my artwork. So here is my 10 by 10 that I am sending to you that is my donated piece.
You guys, if you want like this incredible collection of 12 pieces from June and July, this is one from Betty that I'm going to get really soon, and I'm super excited. So please DM me if you are interested in buying this incredible collection.
So today I'm going to finish this with mark making. So when I get to this point where I've finished up with using paint and making marks using paint, then my final step is also using those same types of tools to do some more intentional mark making at the very end. And it just kind of enhances it. I'm not trying to, do something that is going to drastically change it, but rather to complement and enhance it. So I'm going to be doing that today to finish this off, and then I'm going to get this in the mail to you.
And then what also by using that, it pops colors. So
because
yes. of the different texture, it makes it pop. And so once you get it to that point where you use pastels or charcoal, all the woodies or whatever, what do you do to seal it so they don't, they don't mix up or, you don't get smeared all over? Or what do?
I like to use workable fixative.
Yeah.
That's so I like to spray it. Yep. And that'll hold all of my mark making, especially the ones that are water soluble. So that'll hold them in place so that when I come back in, I like to use Liquitex for my varnish. So this one is a satin, but I've got matte and gloss as well. And so when I come in with this, it doesn't smear my marks. That fixative.
Do you prefer one like matte or satin or gloss? Do you prefer one or the other, or just depends on?
Yeah. It depends. It depends on the piece. So for example, this one back here this one's not done. Actually, I didn't varnish this one. I can tell by the feel. This one I'm probably going to do in a matte. Just because I think it's going to look good in a matte. Now there are other pieces that I've done. Here's one. This one actually is in a floating frame, and this one is done in a satin, and you can see that.
Yeah, you can see the sheen. Yeah.
Right. Right.
Yeah. And your framing? Do you use a framer? Do you do it yourself? What do you?
I do it myself. I'm a DIY kind of girl.
So tell us a little bit about that, and how hard is it, or how easy is it?
It's for me, it's really easy, but my dad was a carpenter. My brother's a carpenter. I have flipped homes. I've flipped a house myself, a townhouse.
Yay,
so
Betty, you're full of like little hidden secrets here.
I love tools. So I'm going to say for me, it's easy to do, but I purchased the floating frames online. Honestly, I can't remember who I got them from. I don't
know.
Don't
worry about it. You can email me later and I can update it later too.
Yeah. I don't know if I'm going to be able to find it because I bought these several years ago. So I want to say it was Jerry's or Blick where I bought them.
Okay.
And then this particular one is a 22 by 28. And it is a half inch canvas. So when I work on a half inch canvas, which I don't do a whole lot of them, I like to put them in a floating frame just to give them a bit more substance.
Yeah, because then you can do like an inch to inch and a half.
Exactly.
And float it in there. Yeah.
Yeah. And it's really easy because all you have to do is get these L brackets at your hardware store and you just attach them there. And then you can see my wiring here attached to the frame, not to the canvas. So, you know, for me, it's easy. These came unvarnished. They were just plain wood. So I varnished them, sanded them lightly, varnished once, lightly sanded, did a second coat of varnish. So I love the natural wood, you know, with my fields of flowers. There's just something about them that, I don't know, I really like that natural wood look.
Well,
with
I
them.
Think that it almost feels like the branches, the trees, you know, it's like the natural feel that you're looking for. But yet it's when you float those frames, they still look modern to me. So
right.
I like the juxtaposition of both things happening at the same time. So yeah, that's amazing.
Here's another one. This one is a commission I did, and I'm getting ready to mail it. It's going to dry for one more day before I put in the mail on Monday. So commissions, of course, I'm going to use colors that the client would like. And this one in particular, she wanted these colors, and also I'm going to be titling it Mom's Garden. It's in memory of her mom. So I'm really honored to have created this for her. So that's going to go out.
Let me ask you something, Betty. Do you find that commissions come in more of a certain size than, let's say, a 24 by 24 versus a 60 by 60, or not necessarily?
Not necessarily. No, I mean, the commission I did before this one was a 36 by 48. So
what about the one just regular sale that comes from your website? Big, or it doesn't really matter?
No, it depends. The one that I posted this morning that sold by the gallery that I belong to, Jayco's, here in Los Gatos, it was I think that one was a 48 by 48. And then the one before that was, I think, a 20 by 20 that sold. So it depends on the price.
I'm right
and what
there with
for.
You. It doesn't, you know, there's no rhyme or reason on
right.
sizes.
Yeah, this is a 24 by 24. So this is one of my recent ones. And this one you can see a little bit of a sheen. This one was done in a satin finish.
Is that on? Oh, yeah. Okay, I was going to. I didn't know if it was a half inch, but yeah, that's a 1 inch. Yep.
Yep. So wraps around. So when they wrap around like this, the deeper ones, then I don't do a floating frame. You can certainly put a floating frame if you want to finish it off that way. But I like to carry my colors around the edges.
Yeah, I love doing that.
Yep. Yeah.
And then they don't need to frame it.
Then they don't need to. And then if they really want to, they can still frame it. Yep.
Right.
So those are a few examples. Plus the one behind me. This one is a 36 by 36 behind me.
Wow. And I'm not sure if you're willing to show us that wall.
Sure.
So when I was talking to Betty, she has used that wall again and again and again. And I said, well, you need to frame that. She's like, well, it's plastic. But
it is. It's plastic and it's cut right here. So, this is, I love this plastic because it has been in here since, so 2016 when I moved here. So it's got, you know, several years of paint drips on it and me painting around the sides and the paint, you know, showing up, getting onto the plastic there. But this plastic is wonderful. I also use it as a palette on my workspace so that I can just put out my paints. So really great. It's 4 mil, so 4 mil, M-I-L, which is a thicker plastic. And you can get that at your hardware store, or you can even get it on Amazon.
Yeah. I don't know what happened when you stood up. I think the internet went kind of just wild, so it's not, you're not focused, but hopefully it will become focused in a minute.
Okay.
But I can hear you. Okay. So there's a question, what do you do about the floor?
Yeah, so on my floor, I've got a rug down here, and then the plastic goes onto the floor, about a foot onto the floor, so that drips can be caught on there. But, you know, this is my studio. I am not clean and neat and organized whatsoever. So here, I'll turn a little bit so you can see. so you can see my floor down here. It's got paint all over it, and here's my little workspace here.
Is there any way that you can, you probably can't do anything about the image that I'm looking at. It's very fuzzy.
I'm sorry. Is everybody else seeing it fuzzy? Maybe we can get folks to respond.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe it's just me. But I can hear you just fine.
Okay.
Hopefully people can see. I'm not seeing. That's weird. It says yes. So where you work, because what I do also is I go to Home Depot too, and it's out of focus, and yes, it's fuzzy. That's what I'm getting. Fuzzy.
Okay.
So maybe.
Let me check my Wi-Fi. I am connected.
Hold on, guys. One second. There. Yes. Okay, we did it. Okay, so when you are working, let's just revisit what you just said. So you put this plastic that you can find it anywhere, pretty much. I mean, I found mine at Home Depot. It's the heavy duty plastic that I use. And you layer it on top of your working floor, but you don't care if you get paint on your floor or whatever, because that's your working space anyways.
Yeah, and actually the plastic is not on my floor. It goes from the wall about a foot onto my floor just to catch drips. And then I've got a rug on top of that that really absorbs all the water.
Okay.
And then I've just got an old, IKEA rug here. I think it's an IKEA rug. I have some cardboard down as well, just to kind of soften when I'm standing here a lot, working larger, that it's a little bit easier on my legs. But other than that, I've got pretty much the same setup in my studio in downtown San Jose, where I've got a large, I've got a 10x10 Berber rug that I purchased for indoor art festival that I used once. And so I thought, I'm just going to set it up in my new studio. No point in having it, in storage here. So I use that and I do the same setup. I've got my plastic on the wall and it goes about a foot underneath that so that it just captures all of the drips coming down.
Yeah, I feel like, like I said, I think I posted it yesterday, I work in so many different surfaces. So I work on a wall, I work on a table, I work on the floor. And mm-hmm. organized chaos in my head works really well because I'm pushed to work in many different directions, and sure. And some inform the other or where I'm going to go. And so do you happen to do the same thing? Do you work on a lot of things at the same time?
I tend to. Okay, so if I'm working small, lately I have been working, I've been creating a whole lot of 5x7 pieces, and I will create like 3 or 4 of them at a time. So I love doing that. I just go back and forth on all of them. They pretty much, they finish, I start them at the same time, I finish them at the same time, which is great. And they do, one informs the other, they're all a little bit different, but yet they all work together really well. Now, when I'm working larger, I tend to work on maybe 1 or 2 pieces at the most. I tend to be very focused when I'm creating large. I've got enough room on there for me to work areas, and it dries as I'm creating, especially during the summer months. I love when my paint dries quickly so that I can continue painting, going one layer after another. So only if I've got a lot of paint on there and I really need to stop and let it dry, then I bring in another canvas and I'll start working on that one.
And I know that you like working with acrylics because they dry fast. And so that is your, your, I guess, what you like to use the most.
Yes. Right? And what would you say, what would be three tips or three or inspirations to people at home to start creating?
Yeah, so I think that, you know, for me, inspiration comes from everywhere. So that could be going for a walk, going for a drive. I'm always looking, I'm observing, and I'm especially looking at lines and shapes. So I am always inspired just every day by something that I'm seeing. Now, the other thing that really gets me going and gets me like, oh, I've got to get in the studio, is when I get on Instagram and I'm looking at other artists' work. And so it's just, you know, I see colors and it's shapes and beauty, and I'm like, oh, I've got to go create something. So I get inspired that way. To be honest, it doesn't take a lot to get me inspired. But, you know, when I was starting out, I was looking for different things. So watching videos helped me a lot. Again, getting on Instagram or on Facebook and seeing what other people are doing, not so much to copy them and to do what they're doing, but, you know, just to be inspired. You know, here, I don't know if you can kind of see, there's, so sometimes I print my own work and I put it up, like pieces that I really like. And so I'm inspired by my own work, because I put this up and I can't necessarily recreate this, but it's kind of a jumping off point. It helps me get started. And then once I get going, then, you know,
is that a copy of your work? Is that like a print paper or?
Yeah. That's just from Costco. I just printed a large one.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I've got a number of these, especially if I'm doing a commission. I ask them to let me know what they like. So this one, actually, I created a commission based off of this one. That's why it's still hanging here. And it's one of my favorite ones, too. So, you know, I think that if we can just find a little something that gets us going, and we just get to the studio and we just get our supplies out and start doing something, I think that just carries us forward. Now, the other thing that helps me a ton is, it's not necessarily inspiration, but what I have found was, and I learned this when I was early on, when I kept listening to YouTube videos, I wasn't watching them, I was listening to them, is I listen to podcasts. And the reason I love to do that is because they engage the left side of my brain. So I am listening to the words being said, the thoughts that are, that surround what is being discussed, the conversations that are being had. And that frees up my right brain to stay creative. And so my left brain is not judging what my right brain is doing. And I found this to be so key when I create. I create my better pieces when I'm listening to a podcast. It can be a podcast about finances or about Black Lives Matter. It could be something that's really heavy and deep, but yet I'm still creating, you know, happy paintings, because that's what I have learned to do by keeping my left brain engaged somewhere else.
Isn't that interesting? I think that a lot of people work that way and they don't even know that that's what's happening. But it just sparks that creativity. But I think because you're getting full of ideas inside your head, and so you are just now making without thinking, which is the best state to be in. So while doing something else and entertaining your brain, it takes that pressure off completely. So I also find very helpful if you have a mat and you kind of move it around in your own paintings and find what's working in that little frame, and maybe photograph that and, you know, make a print of it and say, what is working? Why is that working for me? You know, how is that working for me? And that also can help you move to a different, you know, direction, even in that same painting. You know, don't be afraid of starting again. Don't be afraid of making mistakes. It's all about learning and making those mistakes. Without them, you can't grow.
Absolutely. Right. Right. And one of the things that I really like to do is as I'm creating, as I'm kind of coming more towards the end, is taking a picture and looking at it or turning around and not facing my artwork and looking somewhere else for 30 seconds and then turn around. And where does my eye go first? I'm always looking at where does my eye go first? Okay. Is that an area that needs to be fixed, or is my eye going there because that's a good place to be? More times than not, it's an area that I don't like and I need to fix it. So that helps me a lot to do that on a regular basis. And then also taking a photo and converting it to black and white.
Black and white.
So that you can look at your values.
Yeah.
So stepping
back. Very important to step back from your work.
Yes.
It is, you know, it is as important to be, you know, up close and personal, but it's as important to take a perspective and say, okay, what is working now? What do I have to do? So always, always take a few steps back and sit with it and put your feet up like Betty does. I do the same.
Yeah.
And just take a cup of coffee or tea and just observe. And you're going to learn a lot by just observing without making.
Yeah, get on Instagram for a while, look at something else, and then look up at it. And then you're going to see, oh, I need to work on that spot, or I need to fix that spot. So
exactly. Yeah. Well, Betty, I can't thank you enough. What a wonderful learning experience it was to have you today. You're an incredible teacher. You're an incredible person. I'm very proud to now call you my friend, not only my army of artists, but a friend that I can always call, and I know that you're going to be there and answering me. And so thank you for being accessible to everyone, really, and for being you, really. Your soul comes through your work, and you have a beautiful soul, so you have beautiful artwork.
Thank you, Sandra. Thank you. It's been a pleasure. It's been great meeting you and getting to know you. And I just love being part of what you are doing, which is helping to feed America during this time of COVID. And the money that you are raising is just, you know, so important that we continue to give back. And I think that what you are doing is wonderful. And I love being part of that. And I appreciate everybody who has joined in today. And if you're watching the recording, thank you for watching the recording as well.
Thank you, guys. Thanks, Betty. We'll see you soon.
All right. Thank you. Bye.
Take care. Bye-bye.